Hello and welcome back to Kim Reads as we continue with Phantom. A month later, as we sat together on the veranda taking thick, sweet coffee with crushed cardamoms, a messenger from the Khan arrived bearing a letter which commanded Eric's immediate return to Tehran. As I watched, Eric got up, brought his hands together briefly, almost in an attitude of prayer, then opened them to reveal a heavy purse nursing on one palm. I never received this message, he said. Master? The man took the purse from him and stared at him with obvious bewilderment. You did not survive your dangerous journey through the Elbirds, a landslide, a tiger, a Turkoman. There are half a dozen deaths of solitary messengers could have met. Choose whichever pleases you and disappear. There's sufficient in that purse to ensure you never need to carry messages in it again. Go now and be sure you do not speak of this to anyone. If you betray me, I promise that I will take the greatest pleasure in personally raging your extinction. When the man had gone, I looked up aside. She will send again, Eric. This can't buy you more than a few weeks' grace. 2 months are all that I shall need. To finish the palace? I said in astonishment. Surely that is impossible. He looked down on me with great pity. I am not speaking of the palace, he said gently. I felt suddenly cold, as though all the blood had ceased to run my veins. 2 months, I echoed. Eric, surely you must be mistaken. He must have longer than that. He must. He sat down beside me and leaned forward in his chair, forcing me to look at him. Nay, dear, the child does not deserve to suffer all that will very soon lie ahead of him. What are you telling me? I said numbly. I am telling you nothing, merely asking you to remember that death can come in many shades. Some are harsh and inwardly painful to look upon. Others can be as painful and as beautiful as the setting sun. I am the artist, and many colors lie upon my palette. Let me paint him a rainbow and give you the means to decide where it ends. I let him paint the rainbow. For 2 months, the kaleidoscope whirled, making beautiful, many-hued pictures that still glow in the memory like fresh oils. The sorcery of an incomparable genius focused like the sun's rays on the tender, dry imagination of a child. My house was filled with magic and mystery, as Eric's knew to cause the very earth itself to yield long-kept secrets. Windows open into a world of fantasy, and bridges of music span deep chasms to a strange and secret realm. It was a timeless period of wonder, bound only by the rapid creep of a cruel reality that no magic could keep at bay. 2 months, indeed, were all I needed to see the terrible signpost at which Eric had darkly hinted. That evening, the razor began to choke unexpectedly on a drink I was holding to his lips. I suddenly understand what horrors lay ahead. A dull heaviness closed in around me as I sent a servant to fetch Eric from the palace site. He came at once, and he stood before me in a white mask and his black cloak. He looked every inch the Khanum's angel of doom. Taking a vial from his sleeve, he placed a colorless liquid in a small glass of sherbet and handed it to me. "It will be quick," he said quietly, "and he will feel nothing." I stared at the finality of the glass with horror. "No," I said with sudden panic. "I can't do this. I will let nature take her course after all." He looked at me steadily. "Nature is a cruel and feeling goddess. Will you abandon your child into her merciless hands?" Covering his face, I turned from his relentless gaze. "I am his father. How can you know? How can you understand what it means to take life from your own child?" He was silent for a moment, and then I lay his fingers briefly on my arm. "This is no longer your burden," he said softly. "Wait for me here." Once again, the curious paralysis of will, I watched him take the Quran and pass into the adjoining room. Time slid my limp grasp, and there was a sluggish throbbing in my head that seemed to extend to all my muscles. His voice was like a dead weight in my mind, dragging me down and numbing all inclination to resist. The moment of choice had been taken from me, and now the last sound my son would hear was the voice of an infidel, an unbeliever. Swirling, drowning in that bottomless lake, I grasped the knife of my faith and freed myself from the strangling reeds that were settling around me like a shroud. I broke loose from that spell that bound me and rushed me into the silent chamber beyond. Save for the muted glow of a candle in the prayer niche, the room was in darkness now. All the windows along the garden side of the wall had been pushed wide open to admit the wind that was blowing on the Caspian Sea. Eric turned as I entered the room. For a moment, the wind took his cloak, making it swirl out behind him as he came toward me with all the majesty of a winged angel returning to Earth. "There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet," I whispered hoarsely. There was a faint answering sigh in response, the barest flutter of breath from Reza's slack white lips. The boy was already dead when Eric laid him in my arms. That's the end of that chapter. See you later. Bye.